First of all, I would like to congratulate my colleagues for what he has prepared. It is really deep and exploring. I'm going to not to oppose, but to contribute to what has been said. Principally, I should say there is a problem of the definition. This has always been a problem towards reaching the true reality of the phenomenon. In my position, with regards to the topic you presented, I think I am very lucky to support my contribution, not just because I am an African, but because I am black. I don't want to be a racist, but this is a reality. I don't say because I'm black, therefore I'm an African, but I'm still saying that my blackness with relation to my skin has something to do with concept Africa. At least it gives me a foundation to depart from. This is my point. We all know that Africanhood in relation to skin color has been compromised pretty badly in our contemporary society. Nevertheless, still, there is a foundation to depart from the skin, from the skin color. Who is an African is a question that needs an answer. But I'm afraid that all of these discussions lead to no answer because of the problem of a definition, which always has been attributed wrongly, to assume something wrongly, and categorically we have wrong answers, obviously. If you are aware of what has been said by our previous sayers, that you know, it is better not to define at all than to have a wrong definition. You know, our father Aristotle, Socrates, once said that the one who was considered to be the wisest person in Greece, he said that at least I know that I don't know. This is true because it is better to acknowledge your ignorance than to define a concept in a wrong way. Well, who is an African now? Categorically speaking, I would say an attempt to define an African is an attempt to rationality. Because as it stands, it can be derived. It cannot be derived from any definition whatsoever. There is no definition of who is an African. You know, defining always reflects two things. If you want to define a concept, always it reflects two things, either function or structure. Meaning that, for instance, I may give you a very practical example. What is a mobile phone? So from functionality point of view, we may say it is an electronic device that enhances easy communication. You know, there are electronic functions, there are communication functions, which actually defines what is a mobile phone. This is from functionality point of view. Let's come to the structure. Maybe what is a mountain? From structural point of view, a mountain could be said like is an elevated mass of land from the earth's surface. Something like that. Maybe the geographers will try to help you to define this intrinsically. Maybe what is an island? Like maybe Zanzibar. You know, an island from structural point of view, it's an area of a land that is not connected to any continent, but surrounded by water. So from structural point of view, from functional point of view, is where we get true definitions of phenomena. Now let's come to our context. Who is an African? From functional point of view, not. Who is an African? From structural point of view, nothing. You see, what I mean is, neither by function nor structure can an African be defined. There is no distinctive function that differentiate an African from non-African. Also, there is no distinctive structure that differentiates an African from non-African. What I know is that both Africans and non-Africans have human functions. That's obvious. And also, what I know is that Africans and non-Africans have human structures. Speaking of which, there is neither functional nor structural differences to both Africans and non-Africans. Therefore, by definition, I don't know who is an African. However, knowing my ignorance and acknowledging it does not make me any wiser like Socrates anyway. But I suppose there is another way to approach this this concept, Africa. It is through description. Castor Duda has well attributed who is an African. Those points, he said, were very good. And he spoke something from cultural perspective, from color perspective, from conscious perspective. You know, those I call description. They are not definition. I mean, from my base of contribution, we can only describe who is an African, but we cannot define, because an African, by definition, does not exist. Let me give you an example. I suppose in the year like 106 BC or 106 AD, African was easily described, mainly through color, which is black, specifically from geographical perspective, which means any person who lived in Africa was black. This is year 160. But after a great scientific revolution, industrialization, human mobility, educational transformation, development, and what now we call globalization has hampered this concept pretty bad. Now we cannot know, we cannot define, we cannot describe an African the way we used to describe. Because it's the mobility and making this world look like a village that actually has hampered the whole concept of an African. Now an African can be anyone. Like right now, maybe even Dr. Tadeusz can be inspired to go to the migration office and he say that maybe I want to be a citizen of Tanzania. And after living for 10 years, he can intrinsically assimilate the African culture and love it and live it. Then after 20 years, he's an African. So you can see, now it is very difficult to describe an African from these perspectives. However, maybe there is a hope of the future. I don't know what it is. I have a challenge. Maybe this could be a challenge or whatever you may call it. But seeing that we cannot define an African, we can only describe an African through those what Buddha mentioned before, that through the culture, through color, through consciousness, and whatsoever. Now, I would like you to reflect on the concept of Black Americans, or they're called African Americans. Africans, Americans who live in American continent, some of them refuse to be called Africans because they don't know anything about Africa. They have assimilated American consciousness. Therefore, they are Americans from consciousness perspective. But actually, from the skin color, they are brothers and sisters. They are ours. They belong to our continent, historically speaking. Coming to Africa, there are different, many whites who have migrated from different parts of the world and they have come to Africa for many years, and others have even assimilated our consciousness. We call them Africans, though not openly. But there is one thing. What differentiates me from anyone who would desire to be an African is my Africanness. I'm talking about intrinsic value of an African that cannot be just acquired by legal papers. I call them African Africans, which I may call their true description of an African. So if you, from my end of presentation, if you ask me what is an African now, from descriptive methodology, who is an African? Is an African African. Thank you very much.
Actually, I do appreciate your contribution and reaction to an attack. Have just stipulated, but maybe to add something regarding what you have said, especially regarding the question of definition. Speaking about an African, it should be clear that this an African is a human being, and if we could define human being, then we can have what you have mentioned, maybe structure and function definition. But I'm a man, I'm a human being. But the moment I claim that I am an African, then it should be clear that we have these accidents. So I am the subject from the point of view of I am a human being. But I am not just only a human being. I also have the so-called accidents. For example, we can be 10 people here. We can stand. And someone can say, okay, maybe still because I am tallest, I am the tallest person, then someone can identify me different from the other 9 people. So, sometimes we identify people from the accidental point of view. And that's why somewhere I clarify that the distinction which we are speaking here concerning the identity is not from the essential point of view. Because if we could speak about the concern of essence, then we can speak about the essence of human being, not the essence of an African. This is an African is a person, is a human being. So what we are speaking here is limited to accident. That's why we are speaking about car. This is just an accident by itself. That it just happened that I am a black person. That's why we are speaking about location. It just happened that maybe you are born in Tanzania and he was born in Poland, you see. So at the end, I just cemented regarding this point of consciousness. And I'm quite very happy you mentioned the example of those, the so we call black Americans. But one of my friends told me that they are not apt to be called that. And if you call him, you can just even shoot him. He is an American, or she is an American. Still, because of this, the concern of consciousness, how can you force me to be an African still because of color? Why I have been born in America. They have been there. They are living the culture of America. They have this consciousness of America. So this should be clear that what we are actually articulating here rely more on an accidental point of view. So from accident, we can identify people. Even if, as I see you, I can identify you with the distinction of you from accidental point of view. Okay, they are white, you are black, some are tourist, some are... So actually it's a nice comment and reaction, but we should put this demarcation between our in case of definition, essence and accident.
Yeah. It was a good, for a good presentation. And also I thank the organizers for the good topic we are discussing here about who is an African. For me, I'll take the relativistic point of view in this understanding of an African. And by taking this relativistic point of view, I concur with one point there about consciousness. When you speak about an African, in regard of the culture, we can find many cultures in Africa as we presented. But still, we find difficulties in these cultures. For example, when you were talking about culture, we touched about the issue about religion. The issue about religion and the way you were presenting it, it was like you were attacking the Christianity. Like Christianity is not ours, it is Westerners. But in Africa, we can find many religions. In many religions, not all of them, they are from Africa. The Buddhism, for example, is about Islamic religion. You can find Hinduism in Africa. And those who are worshiping there, there are some who are calling themselves the Africans. So I concur the same point there from that understanding with the definition which my brother said that it's very difficult to define this is an African or what is an African. So if you go to the naturalistic point of view, you can define an African as the way you wish, according to your perspective, point of view. If I'm speaking about an African in the point of view about culture, I can speak of culture, but I go to the particular culture. If I'm in Sukuma, I can go to speak about Sukuma culture. I want to speak about the Africanity in Sukuma people. But if you can find a unique culture within all Africa, you can call it an African. But it's difficult, because if you go in West Africa or North Africa, like Egypt and other Tunisia, you find that they are not black people. They are white people from Asia, most of them. So are you going to define them as the Africans because of their color? You find that it's very difficult. But from the relativistic point of view, it gives you the wide range of view to discuss about who is an African. And an African can be understood in from the conscience. Like you just said that American black American, some they don't want to be called an African or black American. Because of their conscience, they deny that they are not African, I'm an American. Even ourselves here, we identify our Africanity because maybe some we are born here. Some maybe we like to differentiate ourselves from Westerners. Some maybe because they are persecuted by some people from Western countries, they think that to belong there is evil. So I should have to say, an African, you have to secure my position. It's about consciousness. So I just put the whole discussion in a relativistic point of view that everyone can understand an African according to his own perspective. Thank you.
Maybe we should not fall into this problem. We should not fall into this problem. Speaking about Africa, it is an entity which is formed by different societies. So when we speak about African culture, I clarified it when I was at the beginning. We should not think that there should be a single culture which identifies all Africans. Because even all Africans are not the same. That's why it should be clear that Africa is an entity which is formed of thousands of societies. But for example, you just mentioned the question the matters of religion. And I expected someone could say maybe I am attacking Christianity, but in recent I am not attacking. But I am telling the reality. You mentioned Islamic Hinduism, and I could pose a question to you. Now let us take ourselves back before this Western invasion into African soil, because the Africans existed before the invasion. Now the question is, before the coming of Western or foreign people into African soil, now did Hinduism existed? Actually, the answer is no. Was there Islamic, which we are experiencing today? Actually, there was no Islamic. Was there Christianity? No. Now I say Africans had their own way of connecting to the so-called supreme being God. So maybe this is just a simple clarification. Now, also we should be careful regarding the concern of relativistic. Because if we swallow it without being careful, then we will fall into problems. Actually, the aim of this presentation, especially this topic, is to raise a discussion that Africans from their own or relative ethnic groups and societies, they have their own culture. They have their own ways of life. And this is what I'm just trying to convince you so that we can keep on discussing, so that with this globalization, we can retain those African cultural values. Because if we don't, at the end, then we will be okay, black in color, then in mind we are very Western. And this is another kind of slave. If you are in Africa, and you had your own ways of life, and they are not bad, they are good. And if you take them away, and then you just argue the new ways of life, then this is, to me is one of the a kind of slavery, because our ancestors used to live different life. I don't relate to this the concern of culture and dynamism. No, culture is changing, but changing should not mean that to replace. You place what you had, then you put. No, you can just develop this. You can just accept some good value from Western while restoring, maintaining what we as African we used to have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is Elia Thomas Ndengo. I'm a student of this college taking the Bachelor of Law, and I'm in the fourth year. I'm encouraged to contribute in this motion, at least to say what I know according to the topic. Some of the contributors, they have said that it is better not to define than to define something wrong. And what I know, if you say that this is wrong, you have to know what is right. So, and good enough, I think the presenter has never defined, but he has tried to give the meaning. So I think we have known what has been done. According to me, who is an African? When I was taking my course, which known as Private International Law, I remember we defined the citizenship, and also we defined the nationality and the residence. A person may be the citizen of more than one states or countries. A person may be the resident or the citizenship of one country, but the resident of the other. But you cannot be the national of more than one, what? More than one country. So according to me, it is true that maybe it should not be connected directly, the African and the citizenship, but we can connect between the national or nationality with the term. That is to say, you can know who is an African by his nationals. What I mean is that, for example, Tanzania, most of the members of this panel today, we are the nationals, maybe not all of us, we are the nationals of Tanzania. To say that, I know that we are African, but some of us here, maybe they are not the nationals of this world, of this country. And I'm sure that they might also be not the African. So what I say, for example, those black Americans, since they are the nationals of America, though they are black, maybe they have certain cultures, but as long as they are the nationals of America, they continue to be, not to be the African, but the American. We know maybe there are some Africans or some black people who are in maybe Asia. We cannot that they are, if they enjoy the nationality rights of those continents, they cannot be called the African. So to me, who is an African is a person who is very connected with his or her nationality. That is to say, if maybe a European come in this country and register himself bad enough, in Tanzania, we do not encourage the dual citizenship, that the citizenship of more than one vote. If you come and you want to be the citizen of Tanzania, you have to renounce your citizen vote, a citizenship. In that case, you'll be the citizenship of Tanzania, the nationals of Tanzania, and you'll be also the African. Thank you.
First, I'd like to congratulate my fellow Mduda for his presentation. It is a nice presentation, but when I was listening and following his presentation, I was asking myself two basic questions. When you ask who is African, is that a philosophical question? That was my problem. My doubt is, when we talk of identity, we know that when he was presenting, he said that African identity is something which is beyond gender, is beyond culture, and also is beyond geopolitical situation. Then if we agree that African, the identity of Africa is beyond all these, because an identity is that is the fact of being who you are or what it is, yeah? Then if that is the fact and that is the reality, therefore, to ask ourselves as philosophers, who is African philosopher, or who is African identity, or what is an African identity, I think this is a trap, and force most of the African thinkers and African philosophers to treat African identity as an object that we have to point. We need to show that an African identity is all about culture. It's all about race, or color. It's all about that. No, I think that is something, that is the myth that is absolutely wrong. An African identity or an identity, it is just a state of mind. That's why my friend here failed to define who is an African. Because it's just a state of mind. We discuss of Africa because someone somewhere in a certain year called this continent an Africa. It's an African continent. It's a name. So we are now trapped to focus on the names of the location, whether we were supposed to focus on the facts, the phenomena. I mean that let me find a very simple way. Okay, it's like this. When we talk of African, for example, we had in 2 decades that we had a discussion whether African philosophy exists or not. So it was just a trap that African thinkers and philosophers, we were not supposed to discuss whether it is. And in the fact of that discussion, we find some philosophers came with writer, came with some finding, using not African languages. For example, we are discussing who is an African using English language, presenting or discussing about Africanism or about our identity. I think there is something wrong there. We need to wake up and think critically that an Africa is just it's a human, and the identity of Africa should be something permanent that cannot change, and that is rationality. I think that is the correct and philosophical answer for who is or who are Africans. So our identity should be real, should be identified by the rationality, the nature of rationality that the human being we have. Because if we go and say that we are African because of the culture, or because of the culture, we normally we have experienced culture. Culture is changing and will change also. Culture is something which is changing. So if we say today this, we are African because of this culture, and tomorrow we won't be in this situation, we'll be in another situation. That means we will need to redefine who we are. But our mental and rationality will not change. Whether you are in Africa, whether you are in Europe, you are a human being. But once we accept to discuss and to come with a topic like who we are, African, that means we are not philosophers. And the bad thing and what is not good, we agree. Let's agree with what you said, that one of the criteria to be, or one of the identity of one to be an Africa, it's a culture. And when we talk of culture, we talk of the language. But what if this language that we are using is an African language? I doubt that. So it's like we are trying to tell somebody, we are trying to prove to someone that to be, is like somebody is doubting that, are we really African? Then we are trying to justify that we are African by using maybe his or her language. I think the discussion whether who we are African is not important. What is important is the nature and the rationality capacity that we have. And that is something which will be permanent, will not change. Thank you.
My second is for your study. Actually, I appreciate what you have just articulated. It is important, but also it is not important. Why I say this? I say it's not important because I said earlier that failure to define ourselves will give a room for others to define us. Let me give you one example. We have this philosopher here. We just said Africans, we do not have even a history. So we are existing not in Ireland, we are existing in a world. This is what we call a global village. And we are not alone. That's why even here we have people from poets. Now, let me try to clarify this. Let us assume this is just a universe. And people, human beings, all human beings are in this universe. You spoke about the question of nationality. Nationality is what defines human beings. This should be clear. And when it comes to the question of nationality, for me, rationality is the essence of human being. That what makes us to be human beings and not dogs is rationality. Rationality is not an essence of an African world. I am a rational being, he is a rational being, and the Asians are a rational being. So, to show that this discussion is important, that if we could come here and discuss about the question of rationality, it actually would be a surprise, because it could be a criteria that we doubt if we are rational. So for me, the question of rationality is not a matter of discussion, it's just a matter of fact. As long as I'm a human being, then I am rational. What we are discussing here, now, we are in this universe, then it just happened accidentally, there are whites, there are black, there are those Asian, and the others. Now, the question here is, the identification of the so-called Africans in this universe. This is what we are discussing. And this is important because Asians have identified themselves. They have their identification, and maybe whites have their identification. Now, this discussion wants to illustrate that we as the Africans, then we must identify ourselves in this universe. Failure to do so, it means we will be victim of being defined by others. And you have mentioned the question of language. I also clarified this before. We should not fall into this trap that there should be a single language for all Africans for us to say, okay, this is our language. No, this African continent is an entity which is formed, which comprises different societies. Now, okay, I will tell you, okay, for example, I am from England, and we have people from Moshi. They have Chaga language. And if you go to Europe, you won't find even a single person, a white man, who will speak Chaga. So this Chaga language is what defines Chagas. And those Chagas are the people existing in Tanzania, in Africa. So speaking about the fact of language, don't fall into this trap. Some people ask, okay, Africa has no culture. No, this is not true. Because if you say, okay, Africa has no culture, then once someone will trap you, you will fail even to defend yourself. So for me, this is an important clarification, especially for we as Africans. The question here is how we can identify ourselves in this universe. And with this globalization, culture is changing, but we should retain African cultural value in this global village. Failure to do so, you will fall into those scholars who tend to say, okay, Africans have no even history. Now, when I was actually finishing preparing this my presentation, actually I wanted to include this, the concern of African philosophy, but I also realized that it could not be no good connection between what my topic and African philosophy. And I find that this is important because there will be another opportunity for someone else to present a paper. Maybe we can have another discussion regarding the question of African philosophy, because it is also one of the controversial issues that do Africa have their own philosophy? But even now I can articulate and respond by the fact that we are rational beings, and we have philosophy. So I don't want to fall into trap into the discussion of the question of African philosophy here. But my concern was not just, and I am very clear that there is no single definition regarding who is an African. And when we speak of identity, it should be also clear. We don't speak about essence. The identity which we are trying to speak here, for me, is the way I see it. We are speaking on the side of accident, because we are subject, we are human beings, we are rational beings. So all of us here, we are rational beings. Then if it comes, one person come and say, okay, you black person come, you should not complain, because it is trying to identify you different from the other. And then by saying so, it doesn't mean that you are not rational being. So for me, this is one of the good clarification. Africans, we have to enter into this discussion concerning our identity, not as what maybe you grasp, but essence. No, from the point of view of accident, we must define ourselves.
Thank you. Your nice presentation. I don't want to pretend to be having an answer to your question, which you have presented on. But I think I can provide, as a philosopher, an approach which we can take if we really want to be candid and true in searching for a definition or an answer to that. I realize that your question is about identity. You're questioning about the identity of an African. Now, identity is a metaphysical category, if we go back to Aristotle. But through reading Martin Heidegger, he says that we, to know identity, there are two other categories, metaphysical categories, which are necessary. Not important, necessary. One is relation, the other one is difference. So, if we want to really ask ourselves and answer to this question, who is an African, we need to answer what is the relationship between Africans. What makes you, me, and the other be called African? What is there that we share? That is from the side of relation. We have to answer this. Then, from the category of difference, we have to find out what makes these people whom we say are Africans different from others.
Is it color? I'm not giving an answer, I'm suggesting. Is it color? Is it culture? Is it the geography? The continent we call Africa and the other elements. I also read a very strong woman called Marimba Tani. She's a black American. She wrote a book in 1992. She wrote a book called Yoruku, an African-centered critique of European or Western thought. In this, she has coined her own words. To bring out the difference, she says we have to go beyond culture. We have to find that what she calls uttama asili or uttamaroho, that principle which operates in culture. We say Africa, we have many cultures. Is there a principle, is there something that operates in all these cultures? You read this book, she has her suggestion. She asks, is there something, a principle that operates different Western countries? We have many countries, they have different cultures. Polish people don't share a common culture with Italians. Their culture is not the same with Germans, it's different. But what makes us think or claim that it's a culture? That they are white, and they white because of something. She tells us we go beyond the culture and find out that operating principle which operates in these cultures and which makes us see these people as one. According to her, and I'm not subscribing to this definition, but it indicates if we want to answer this question, the kind of work we need to do. For Africans, he says there is the principle that operates in African culture is how we relate with reality. How we see reality. According to her, Africans, they see reality, they know reality by connectedness to that reality, by connecting to reality. And for non-Africans, especially Western, she says, for them, what operates in their culture is, for them to know reality, it's not through connecting to reality, but objectifying reality. You take that which you want to study, you bring it out, then you analyze, you study that. And by doing that, you become powerful, you dominate that which you are studying. And through that, she comes to a conclusion. That's why Western country, they are almost by nature, or it's almost in their DNA that they will seek to dominate reality. While Africans will seek not to dominate, but to connect the part of that reality. So, your topic, Castor, is an evidence that the simple questions do not normally have simple answers. It's something that requires straining our minds, sticking to the method, the approach, finding an answer. Otherwise, we end up answering with emotions and then with prejudice, then we miss the point. So we need to be faithful to an approach. What criteria do we want to take? Lastly, again to say congratulations. Apart from being an exercise, academic exercise, for, on your part, it's a preparation for your defense, which is soon coming, 2 months. And every moment is a moment of learning. See, for example, today you had a problem with the projector. So you get prepared that same thing does not happen on the day of your defense. Thank you.
The contribution of which our doctors stipulated, maybe as a stimulus to all of us here. We have to be very careful with what our actual doctors mentioned regarding to the book, especially the one who wrote it, especially this principle which seems to relate all Africans by saying that Africans, the connection, are connected to the reality. Because from this point of view, we can just, also for me, we can follow this track that we are not critical. We cannot analyze the object. It's like we hug the object. And by hugging, we are emotional. So as a stimulus to all of us, let us be very careful. Because for me, as far as we are rational, we can analyze an object. So those who propagate this kind of reality of Africa, that they are connected to reality, it's like we cannot keep a distance, an object a distance and analyze. This is typically the same as concluding that we are emotional beings. We are not rational. So this is also a matter of investigating. I know you will, I will find the book and I will read, because we should not react to a statement without having concrete arguments. So, but as a stimulus to you, let us not fall into the trap easily. Maybe reading it or hearing it and say, okay, maybe this can be true, that this can be a principle which Africans share, that the way they are connected to the reality is as what has been stipulated. Let us be very careful so that we cannot fall into this trap that we are only emotional beings. Because for me, those emotional beings are the ones which fail to analyze an object, and they tend to hug it. So this, actually, I appreciate, Doctor, your comments, and I would appreciate if you provide me that particular book so that I